We're gonna have two get requests. One will try to get the weather. The other one will try to get events in our local area. What we wanna do is take these two requests, run them on separate threads, executing at the same time, and then collect the results. And depending on the weather, we will either go to an outdoor event or an indoor event. Just a simple example to show you how threading can work. And before anyone says anything, I know you can do this with async await, but for the purpose of this video, I'm just keeping things simple. I'm going to use two different websites to get the APIs. I'm going to use openweathermap.org, which will give us our local weather. And I'm going to use predicthq.com, which will give us events that are happening near us. So once we've created our account, we go to this address. Then we type in the name of the key that we want. So we'll just call it my key. And then you click generate. For PredictHQ, you need to go to control.predicthq.com. And here we can go to API clients. And then from there, we can create a new client and generate an API key from there. So now we go back to our project and we need somewhere to store the API keys. So we're just going to create a file and we're going to call it .env for environment. And we're going to put our API keys in here. So we could say open weather. And let it equal to, you know, whatever our API key is. And then for predict, we could do predict secret and make that equal to whatever API key is. First, we're going to go to CargoTaml. We're going to use env file. Let me see. There we go. And now we're going to set the environment file to our .env, so let env file go env file new, and we give it a path, we're going to have to import some of these, so import path. We probably also need to import env file as well. Now we're going to set our API secrets to the two environment variables we just put in .env. Set weather API secret equal env file dot get, and then we do whatever we called it, open weather, and then I'll expect an error, just failed to open, something like that. And then we're going to do .toOwned, and I'll explain why in a minute. But it's basically when you're passing values to a thread, it's better to own them. It makes it simpler because otherwise you start running into moved value issues. And do the same for event. And the same here, two owned. We also have to have an IO result in main when we're using this env file. We just return OK at the end. Let's just try cargo build that, see how that goes. Okay, yeah, sorry. Small typo, should be capital. There we go. Right, okay, now that we have our API keys, let's start writing our multi-threading. We're going to need an event thread. For the events coming in, we're going to need a weather thread as well. So let's do the events one first. That's that equal thread builder. New. So we need to import threads first. Import that. We start a new builder and then we're going to give it a name. So we can call it string from event thread. Right now, let's spawn the thread. So spawning will take ownership of the new built thread. And we will have a kind of closure in here. And we're going to pass in a method called events. It's going to be in a RS file called events, but we haven't created that yet, but we're just getting ready. So, and we're going to pass in our event API secret. And now we will expect any errors. Event thread failed to spawn. That's just our error handling. But we're going to have to create a new file. We can call it events. And we're going to mod library. It's going to be public function events. So this is the function that we're passing in the closure. It's going to be API thing. Turn events client equal. Okay. I should explain that we're going to make a GET request to predict HQ, get a JSON response, and with that response, we're going to parse for particular values that we want and combine that with the weather API that we're going to call later. And together, we're going to join those to give us a nice response according to the weather and what events are on. Cargo Tom will get this dependency first, request. So we're going to use version 10.8 features, blocking, and JSON. JSON so we can parse the JSON, and blocking because we're not going to use async await for this video. It's just about multi-threading. So now we can go back to our events. So this is going to be where we're going to store our event struct. But for now, let's just first create our request. So let client equal request blocking. Sorry, we need to include it on the module tree. So let's mod events on main. Now we can use a request blocking. Blocking client new. Make a new client, and then we're going to use that client to make a GET request. So let response equal client.get. Now we're going to get our URL. So I have my DictHQ URL over here. I'm just going to paste it in. And I basically got that from PredictHQ. You can do sample queries on their website and figure out what kind of request you want to write, and you can just copy it in. So I'm setting the longitude and latitude here, and it's going to get events in that area. So this is based off London. It's going to give us events in London. And now we need to pass our API secret. So that's going to be in our GET request, so it knows it's coming from us, that it's valid. Then we send it, and we unwrap our response, and then we parse it into JSON. So this is where we get our event struct, and I'm going to write that in just a minute. And then we unwrap that and return response. It's that simple. Now we have to write this event. So let's add another file called lib. So I'm going to need Serday and Serday JSON to do a lot of this serializing and deserializing. It's a great library in Rust for doing handling JSON. So Serday equals version equals 1.0. And features goes derive. Okay, And we're going to get Sardae.json as well because we want to use one of its features. Back to our events, or lib. Let's go to lib. So we're going to use Sardae deserialize. We're going to use deserializer. We're also going to use hash maps to handle some of the values that we don't really care about. And then we're also going to use Sardae.json. Oops, not user. Sardae.json value. So we get this value. So we're going to have events in here, but we're also going to have weather structs. So I'm just going to put a little comment here to let myself know that this is stuff for events. What we need to do is we need to derive deserialize from Sardae. It's like a map. So deserialize, and we're also going to use debug so we can print them out if we need. And then we're going to write our struct events, and we're going to have our count, which is i32. So these are all values that you can get from the API. So if you go on predict HQ, it'll show you, like, you do an example query, you can see what fields it's going to have. So that's where I'm getting this from. It's just all the fields that I know they return. And we're going to have option string, because sometimes I think it can be null. Previous. Some of these values are kind of useless, to be honest, but we just put them in anyways. What we really just need is a description so we can see if the day is cloudy and rainy. And if it's cloudy and rainy, then we do an indoor event. Otherwise, we do an outdoor event. So we need to know which events are indoors or outdoors. Then we have this results. So results will be a vector of results. And this will be like all the different events that come in. To save some time, I'm just going to power through this. Let's speed this up. I'll talk to you guys at the end of it and explain what I've actually done here. All right. All right, so this next one, I'm just going to stop here for a sec and explain. So we're going to use Sardae deserialize with. So this allows us to deserialize with our own deserializer. And the reason we want to do this here is because this next value is going to return null. And for some reason, I haven't figured out exactly how to handle that. So I found this is the best way to handle it, is just by creating our own deserializer and then just handling the null value ourselves. So I'm going to have this aviation rank. And sometimes it can have a value and sometimes it doesn't. Put in this deserializer, I'm going to call it parse nulls. And I'm going to write this function parse nulls. So parse nulls, and we're going to have to give it a lifetime of DE. Now we're going to pass in D, which is going to be, you know, whatever is coming from the API. And then we're going to have a result. And our result will be either i32 or it will be an error from that thing we're trying to parse. And it's going to be where our type is the serializer with a lifetime of DE. All right, so now we use deserialize. Then we're going to use deserialize again from this. And we're going to pass in the D value. We're going to deserialize that. And we're going to map that result. So like you would map anything else. So X, and it's going to be an option of whatever. Could be anything. And then we're going to try unwrap that. So x.unwrap. And if it doesn't unwrap properly, we're just going to pass 0. So because that's an I32. So instead of getting null or some other weird value, we're just going to have 0. Oh yeah, I forgot to close this. There we go. And that's our parse nulls. So that'll just take anything, and if we don't get a value, we can just put 0 rather than getting null, which is a little bit better. Now I'm going to continue writing this. We can do the same for the next value as well. So I'm going to parse nulls also for I PHQ attendance, because I know this value can also be null. And then pub entities. And we're going to have a vector of entities. I'm going to write that in a minute. And now finally, the rest of the values we don't care about. We might use entities, but what we're not going to use, we're not going to use the rest of the values. We don't really care about them. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to use a thing called Serday flatten. So I'm going to quickly do this. And this will just allow us to put all the values into a hash map and not care about them. So I'm just going to call it ignore hash map. Going to be a hash map of string and value. And value is this import that we just have here from Serday.json. Now that we have that written, we need to just write entities. So I'm just going to go ahead and do that. Rust has something called type. One of the values that entities gives us is called type. So I'm just going to do this Serday rename. This is turning more into like a lesson about Serday, but whatever. Multithreading and Serday. So we're going to do deserialize equals type. We can rename this to venue type instead of just type, which would give us problems. And now let's just first we have to mod lib into the main. Let's also use mod lib events. Let's make sure that main knows where our events folder is. We're going to give it a path of events.rs. And that allows us then to access lib set events equal events thread dot join. Dot expect fail to join events thread. Now it's called event thread. All right. And you can see here join gives us a bit about it. So it waits for the associated thread to finish. And the thread attempts to join itself, or otherwise may create a deadline. So you can read all about the different features that you have in multi-threading in here. And now we should be able to print that out. So print line events. I think we implemented debug, so we should be able to just straight up print that out. Just do cargo run. Okay, we have a little spelling mistake. Teen string. Okay, fine. Okay, so we fixed the spelling mistake. Let's cargo run. There we go. So we got our API result. Right now it's a bit of a mess, but we'll tidy that up soon. So the same as we did with events, we're going to do the same with weather. Get weather thread thread builder view dot name string from, and I'm just going to say weather thread. I'm going to spawn that. To do weather and forecast to our weather secret and expect We'll handle any errors, we'll expect. Event, or sorry. Weather, thread, fail, spawn. Great. And then we can do let weather equal weather thread dot join. And we have a join for weather as well. So now we have to create our weather Rust file. And let's add that to Git. So as you can imagine, we're going to use library forecast. Oh, before we continue, let's do the same as we did here with events. We're going to add our weather so it knows it exists. Now we can mod lib into weather. So lib forecast, mod lib, public if function forecast. Am I spelling forecast right? Okay, I'm not actually spelling forecast. There should be an E in forecast. Oops. Okay. And we're going to take in the API. It's going to be string. This is going to look very similar to what we did with threads, but slightly different because we're sending the GET request to a different place, and we're going to use forecast as our struct. So now let's set URL equal. We're just going to format. Oops. Actually, URL equal format exclamation marks. So this is a macro we can use. Format strings for us. So we're going to, I'm just going to copy in this open map weather map API string that I have. And now I'm going to have entered the values of London. GB, I think, or is it UK? I'll try UK, see if that works. And the API secret. So the API secret goes at the end here of the URL, unlike a little bit different to events. Now we're going to write the client. Client equals quest blocking get. Oh, no, sorry, blocking client. New, and now we're going to let the response equal client. Oops, client should be able to do client.get. Oh, yeah, okay, we didn't do let here. Let the client, so now we can do client.get, and we're going to get our URL, pass that in there. Send it. So we don't need a bearer auth like we did because the API is in the URL. Send and then unwrap. Then JSON. So JSON is going to be forecast. And we're going to have to write that in lib like we did before in a minute. So unwrap that. And now we return response. Okay. So now we go to, so now if we create this forecast struct, we have all our stuff for events. And so above it, we can put in forecast. We'll go here. So I'm going to skip over this and I'm just going to put in the code and show you guys when it's done. Okay, and we're done. So what we have here is forecast. And we have all of these different values for forecast. And we want these first few, but we don't really care about the last few. So we're just going to ignore those like we did before in events. Yeah, we're interested more likely in this value description. And that's in details. And details is in weather, which is the second value in forecast. This is the one we're really interested in. Now, let's go back to our main. We have this written already, so we should be able to just print out our weather. Hopefully this works. I might have to tweak the API a little bit if it doesn't. I'm going to put a question mark here to get the result from weather, to handle the result. And all right, so I'm just going to comment out events so it doesn't clog up my terminal. Okay, right, I put in serialize, so let's just quickly remove that. Don't need that. Don't need that. That. Okay. Okay, it doesn't really like our error handling because we're implementing IO result, and that's not what we get from here. So to overcome this for now, I'm just going to use unwrap, but you should do your error handling a bit better than that. For the sake of this tutorial, let's just unwrap the value. It will panic if there's nothing there. Okay, great. So what we're getting is our coordinates, our details. So we're getting a haze, description haze. So it's a hazy day. For the sake of this video, let's just say we don't like haze. But we have something that we can reliably clear out. So first, let's start getting the events right. So I'm going to do this, get all events. We're just going to start filtering out some of these results. So I'm going to get a vector of string. What's this going to be? Is it going to get events, and we're going to get results from events, and we're going to iterate through that. And we're going to map the titles, so we know the title of all the different events. Okay. And we're going to get x.title.collect. Right, great. And now we're going to want events. It's, let's say it's a cloudy day or a hazy day in this case, just for the sake of argument. We don't like haze. We want to stay indoors when it's hazy. So what we could do is we could do collect the events for that particular type of weather. So cloudy haze events. And we're going to do vec of double string reference. And we're going to do all, we're going to get that from all events. I'm going to iterate through that. And we're going to filter x. So as long as it doesn't contain outdoor. We don't want anything with the title of outdoor, like outdoor activities, outdoor sport. We don't want any of those on our cloudy days. And also, I don't want anything with a long title because that just clogs up my terminal. So for the sake of this video, anything that has a title of less than a length of 25 is good. And then we just collect that, basically. Now we can do an if statement. So if, hold on, yeah. So if weather, then we're going to get weather. Then we're going to get details. Then we're going to get description. And then we're going to see if it contains the word haze. So let's see, yes, it contains the description haze. Then that's a kind of day we don't want to be outside on. We only like sunny days. So then we're going to only print out events for a hazy day. And now we get our cloudy hazy events just. Great. Otherwise, if it's not a hazy day, like a sunny day, I mean, we'd need to handle rain and stuff, but for this, we'll just handle hazy days. So let's just say we like rain, just not haze. So here are events for a nice day. Right. So now we have events for both types, and we're going to all events out in this case. So this will print out every kind of event, and this will only print out events that don't include the word outdoor. You can run both of these at the same time, event thread and weather thread. And while they're trying to fetch from the servers, and let's say the servers are really slow, they can still be working on the next API, next GET request while the first request is going. And it just saves you a bit of time. And then at the end, you can join them together and do whatever you want with them. I don't want to get rid of this first print statement. There you go. So Events for a Hazy Day and Insomniac Rewind and Alice in Wonderland. I suppose going to see Alice in Wonderland is a nice thing to do on a hazy day. That's it. I hope you enjoyed this tutorial. If there's anything questions about, leave in the comments below. Please subscribe. I'm going to try to increase my content output in the next while. I kind of was slacking, and the reason why is I have a new position and I will talk about that soon. But that's a story for another day. See you in the next one.